Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined this edition, because we're doing 2 weeks, by the master of memes himself, Webby, Alex Webb. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me, man. It's a pleasure.
Thank you very much. I mean, I've enjoyed your YouTube videos for that long, and actually I've seen you wrestle a few times as well, so I'm really glad that you agreed to be on. To be honest, you got more YouTube subscribers than I do, so really, you're doing me a favour.
I have no clue why. I'm not funny, so...
You say all the funniest people don't think they're funny, so that's a bit of modesty on your part. Right, so the first question, same question as always, how did you get into pro wrestling? And you're going to make me feel really old, I can just feel it.
I'm 23, like, that's not that bad. but I feel like for me it's a bit different, because a lot of people have like a definitive moment where they're like, yes, I've seen big sweaty men fight, now I want to be a big sweaty man and fight other big sweaty people. But for me, I kind of have like several different kind of bits where I was like, where I seen wrestling, I was like, oh, I really like that. The first thing that comes to mind was, I think it was, I went down to my granddad's in Ayr. I think this must have been like 2006-ish, and he was like a huge wrestling fan. And I never had like seen wrestling, I never really paid much attention to it, just not, wasn't something I was like interested in. So I would have been about 8 years old, I think. And so I went up there, and I think SmackDown was on, like, you know how it used to play on Sky Sports?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so my granddad had it, and he was like, oh, you want to watch wrestling? I was like, sure. I was eight, I didn't really know. Sure. So he put it on, and I think, like, the first, like, kind of thing I seen was, it was King Booker versus Rey Mysterio, and I think Booker T had just won the World Heavyweight Championship from him. And like, it sucked me in seeing all this. I think it was like a storyline there as well, where like Ken Kennedy had like had a bit of his head like kicked open or something like that. Or maybe I might be talking out my arse, that's something I can remember. It was just like seeing Rey Mysterio, King Booker, and seeing how invested my granddad was in it. I was like, oh, this is really cool. This is really interesting. And I just kind of like got sucked in from there. But then afterwards, I didn't really keep up with it, didn't really watch it until I picked up the games. And I think if you've watched my YouTube or anything like that, you can kind of tell that like the games is where a lot of my passion came from. I think I said in my very first video, it was like my love of wrestling really came from playing, I think it was SmackDown 2, Know Your Role. Because it was just, I know. I think seeing wrestling and seeing like watching WWE kind of got me invested in like the characters and the pageantry and all like the over the top antics of it. But playing the games kind of like made me a lot more invested in like the moves and like how stuff looks and like the actual matches, if that makes sense. And I think from there afterwards, like, this is so over the place. I think from there I got to like, I want to say I just put on Sky Sports, and I started watching Superstars. But the very first thing I can remember is, like, it was a special on Edge. He was just coming back from the Rumble 2010, which is really weird, considering he just came back in the Rumble 2020 last year. But, yeah, I think that's where I kind of was like, right, I'm watching this now. I'm really invested in it. And I just kind of snowballed from there up into the point where I am now. I guess you could call me a wrestler. So, yeah.
Well, I think Joe Henry said in the past, as soon as you take a wage, you're a pro wrestler. So... I'm hoping that you class yourself as pro wrestler.
I take a wage, so yeah.
Exactly. So yeah, you're a pro wrestler. So yeah, 2006, that's fine. I don't feel super old then. I had her in the Sky on. She's like 17 or something like that. And her first memory was something really recent. I was like, oh God.
When I listen to some of the like, younger guys and they tell me like, oh, I started watching in like 2012. I'm like, am I old now? What is going on?
Well, someone that started in 1998. Yes, I am old. So I'll do that. But 30, it's fine. It kind of correlates the same kind of age and time. So King Booker and Rey Mysterio. So that was a very interesting time to come in, because I was just post Eddie Guerrero, Rey Mysterio stuff.
Yeah.
It was a weird time.
Was it not like, I think Eddie like cost Rey the the World Heavyweight Champion? I have no clue. I might be talking out my arse, but I think
Eddie died at that point. So Eddie died in 2005, and that's how Rey Mysterio won the Rumble in 2006, because he was doing it for Eddie.
Was it, would it have been Chavo by any chance then?
It was Chavo. Yes, it was.
edit that out. No, I'm kidding.
No. We'll keep that one in. That was the whole thing. But yeah, that was the whole summer as well. It was Chavo and Rey. It was a very uncomfortable. Now that I'm looking back on it, it was a very uncomfortable time in wrestling. But I was having the same chat with Jason Hyde where we were speaking about, right about the same time actually, Edge becoming the champion and doing the live sex celebration. At the time, I was 16 and thought it was incredible. At 30, it's not good.
Yeah.
But
especially like if you hear like Edge and Lita like talk about it and like how uncomfortable they were, and then Vince was like, "You have to be naked underneath the covers," and I'm like, "Oh no."
Yep, it was one of the few times I watched Raw live. What a time to do it for that. Anyway, so how did you go from that point of watching wrestling? So you had a 4 year of just playing the games and not really properly watching to actually go back to watching it. How did you go from 2010? To debuted in 2017, according to Cage Match, the Germans. So how did you get to the actual training part of wrestling?
I really liked wrestling. I always told Mum, "Oh, don't worry, I'll never do it," because she'd be scared in case I'd hurt myself, as the fragile little boy I am. But so I think I started looking up where places were nearest to me, and obviously the school in Dundee was closest to where I was. I think I got to the point where I had finished high school and I was just starting college, and I wasn't really doing anything with my time. I was kind of like, as any 18-year-old was, I was just kind of like going out with my mates, drinking, having a good time and whatnot. But I think I was like, I was getting to the point where I was like, I was a bit bored of what I was doing. I wasn't really doing much. I was like, I just started college I don't want to say I wasn't invested in it, because I'm still doing it, like I'm just on my final bit of the degree right now, but it was kind of something I wasn't as interested in at the time. So I was like, I need something to do. And I always said I wanted to be a wrestler. And I always said I wanted to like do something with it, or at least give it a go. So I think I finally, in like 2016, I want to say like October, November time, I might be a bit wrong on that, but that's when I was like, right, I'm going to go do it. So I messaged the school. And literally, they were like, "Oh, we have an induction, like tomorrow, and then you can't come until like next year." So I was like, "Screw it, I'll go over." So the next day, I got on the train, went down, and I think I really enjoyed it. Because it wasn't like anything drastic or anything. It was like set goes and whatnot, fighting stance, that kind of stuff to begin with. And I think from there, I was like, "Oh, I kind of really enjoy it." And I think kind of just kept on going from there, and I kept on training until obviously I ended up debuting in 2017. Yeah.
So how long was it from you actually training to debut?
I personally, looking back at it now, I think I debuted way, way too early, because I think it was only like 4 months until I was like, right, you're on the show, have fun. Because I'll go back and I'll watch that debut match and I'll be like, for 4 months it's all right, but I feel like with only 4 months of like actual training, I should have been like not debuted as quickly, if that makes sense, because I don't think I was particularly ready to start wrestling on shows. I feel like I should have been like kept a little bit longer, if that makes sense, to just like hold my craft, I want to say, so I wasn't as like rusty.
Absolutely. I think around about that time, from what I remember off the top of my head, there was kind of like a purge of people going in and out there as well. So I don't know if they were just trying to fill gaps as they could. Because I think around about the same time, guys like Ken Caden and JD Wild are all coming in. Because when I was doing the results, there was a lot of names. I was going, who's this guy?
Cheers. I think Kenny was in Australia at the time, so he was out. JD was still there. There was other guys there as well, like Steven was. I think he was had one of the mid-card titles at the time. He was I think he was there at the time. So I had obviously just came in, and I think they were like, they were needing people to put on shows, and they're looking for people to be ready. So they were just like, he seems adequate. Let's push him onto the show. So I think that's how I got put on.
So one of your biggest rivalries, actually, before I get into that, what was your first impression? So you did, you have an athletic background, and so was the actual stop set goes on that.
Not really. Like, I was in high school. I was always like somewhat like slim, and I was always kind of like I could always like had decent-ish cardio, I want to say. Like, because I started going to the gym at like 16, and I was like, I'd always do like cardio stuff because I was scared to go to the weight room at that age because there's big strong men there, and I am not a big strong man. But no, I would always do like cardio and stuff like that when I was younger. So I was okay when it came to like doing the cardio stuff when it came to training. I think where I struggled with was like a lot more of the like heavy lifting aspect of it. So like to begin with, my scoop slams are horrible. But like, I just think it's obviously with more practice that kind of came with it. But I think to begin with, my cardio was decent enough.
I was always really... the case. Well, in high school anyway, I just know all boys, including myself, we just ran everywhere. So cardio was set.
Well, like even like walking to high school and stuff like that. But like in general, I didn't do much PE apart from like the mandatory stuff and whatnot. I was always a much more like artistic kid, I want to say. Like in high school, like I did hires in art and drama, so you can tell what I was mostly interested in.
I was pretty much the same. Well, except the drama bit, because I just found that boring. I think it's just because maybe it's just the people I was with. I don't know. I just sat there just thinking, I hate all this. Let me just draw some pictures. I'd rather do that.
Fair enough. I think for me, it was the idea of like improvising with like my mates and just like pissing about in class was something that I really enjoyed doing. And obviously that kind of transpired into me actually kind of liking acting by the end of it. And I guess you could say it has helped me in wrestling, because wrestling is a like 50% acting, I guess. So you could say that.
Oh yeah, it's a 365-day-a-year panto. That's pretty much
definitely
what it is. Did you find when you made your debut then, 4 months in, can be quite daunting, but with that background in performing drama and performance and all that kind of stuff, did you find it quite easy just to roll with the crowd?
I think in terms of being in front of the crowd, when I actually got out there, I was fine. But beforehand, and I'm like this with most, like, every matches, I was like, so nervous. Because, again, I think more so with my first match, because it's my first match, and I don't want to go out there and just, like, screw everything up, if that makes sense. But I was decent enough when it came to actually dealing with a crowd. And I think that kind of got better and better as I went along with continued wrestling and doing matches. It also helped that I was in with someone that, like, is very good. I was in with Jay the Jackal, and I feel like he actually I feel like he kind of like helped me and kind of like kept me along the right track in the match, if that makes sense. So yeah, I feel like that was at least the positive aspect of that.
Oh yeah, and the crowd there, from my memories when I went to the shows way back when, they're up for wrestling. They just want to see some wrestling. They're not that caring. They don't care that much about who does what, and that they just want to see some big sweaty dude slapping meat, so to speak. So one of your big standout rivalries there was with Ian Ambrose, who was one of my favourites when I was going down there, way down to Dundee. So what was it like working with Ian?
I always wanted to work with Ian. I remember when I first started, like I've always been really interested in like the technical side of wrestling. Catch-can wrestling and stuff like that. And I think Ian was one of the best people there at doing that style of wrestling. So, and I didn't get a chance to work with Ian until midway through 2018. So I'd been wrestling for about a year, I want to say like just about a year and a bit at that point. And I remember like got pulled aside and was like, right, we're wanting you to do something with Ian. And I was like, yes. because I just think Ian was someone that I really wanted to get in there with and kind of mash our styles together. And I think getting the chance to work with him and having the chance to do like three different matches, all very different matches, was like a really good opportunity for me as well, for me because it was someone that I wanted to work with, and I also think the matches kind of came together pretty well.
And of course, Ian is very much a promo guy as well. So you got to be a bit more creative with video editing with promos, and be able to actually do.
He doesn't hold back on his promos as well. So it's like I had to give him as good as he gave me. So I feel like in terms of promo as well, it helped me kind of up my game with what, like, how I said and how I delivered lines and how what I was saying in the promo. Like the context of it really mattered, if that made sense.
Absolutely. Was one of your matches at the Caird Hall? Am I right in thinking that?
The first match was at the Caird Hall. The second was in Ardler, and the third was at the Bonner because that was my last match.
All right, so that's three pretty, I would say iconic, but that makes it sound bigger than it possibly could be. But it's three of the more special venues for that company. So what was it like, I mean, did you grow up around about Dundee? Was the Caird Hall quite like a, sorry, okay. So what was it like going into the Caird Hall for that match?
Like, I didn't get the kind of grandness of the Caird Hall that made sense to begin with, but then you get in there and you see it fill up and I'm like, oh, it's actually like there's a lot of people, and like it's kind of like a big kind of nice venue as well. I think I really enjoyed it, but I actually genuinely think I preferred, if you're talking about venues in Dundee, I genuinely think the Bonner Hall was probably my favorite place to work for that company because it was just a lot more intimate. It was like a kind of like nice little entranceway that you like would come down. It just felt a lot more personal and intimate with the crowd, so I really enjoyed that aspect of it.
Oh yeah, the Bonner would have been one of my favourites to go to as well. Mainly because I was coming down from Elgin, so it was about, I don't know, 2 hours to come down here, and the Queen's Hotel was literally across the road, so I could just go in, dump my stuff, and then go straight over. And that exact same, it's quite intimate. That entranceway was really cool, and it reminded me of things like I don't know if you've gone back and watched things like Madison Square Garden, Royal Rumble 2000.
Yeah.
And seen the same way.
I don't want to compare it to Madison Square Garden.
Oh, no, not at all. But the setup looks similar. That's where the comparison ends for it.
Yeah, fair enough.
So your Loser Leaves match was with Ian Ambrose, of course, as you said. So was there a particular reason why you were deciding to move on, or were you approached to say you're out? What were your thoughts going into that final match?
Well, I'll let you in a little secret. It was supposed to be Loser Leaves. I was supposed to come back. But then I think stuff between me and the booker happened, and I was like, right, I don't want to come back to this company, which worked out completely for the better. But I think yeah, that was kind of the case with that match. But again, I don't think it dampens on the match because, like, I think the crowd itself is really invested in that Loser Leaves match. Looking back at it myself, I'm my own worst critic when it comes to matches. If you're going to ask me about any of my matches, I'll always be like, I could have been better in that. I could have been better in this. But I feel like in terms of the crowd, they're really invested in that. So I feel like the Loser Leaves step did work for that. But yeah, I think for me personally, it's probably worked out for the better because obviously what's happened, I think it's best that I've moved on, and like I feel like moving on's opened a lot more doors for me, if that made sense.
Absolutely.
How many times have I said that made sense? If this is like a tally on this, I'm probably in the double digits at this point.
It's absolutely fine. So we'll kind of close that chapter because we'll move on and we'll talk about fun stuff where we can actually say things. But before we close that entirely, what was, say, one of couple of your favourite matches from that time? Outside of the Ian Ambrose ones.
I always really enjoyed working with Stephen. I think obviously as we're a tag team now, I think working with him was always something I really enjoyed doing. Plus he's up for anything. And I think we kind of mesh really well. He's a lot more flippy than I am. But I think him doing flips around me and me like just hitting him in the face is always a pleasant experience. I also enjoyed working with Jason, Zach Leon as well a lot of the time. Just because I think we came in at the same time and we had kind of similar mindsets of we're new, but we want to like prove that we're just as good as anyone else on the card. So he kind of came into that with that mindset, and I think we kind of had some really good chemistry with our matches.
Absolutely. Right, okay, so when I first saw you properly live was for United Pro Wrestling. It would have been the Bucky shows, because that's the only time I went to UPW, because my folks live in Bucky, so it was nice and easy to go to. So different environment, but very similar as in who was being used. So what was it like going in front of a new crowd for the first time?
I think I really enjoy going in front of new crowds because it gives me a chance to just try stuff out and see what works, what doesn't work. I think at the time I was a heel in Dundee. So, and I think going to United Pro gave me a chance to work on my face persona because I'm a big old baby face. So so when I got booked there, they were like, we're using you as a face, try and get the crowd really invested. So it was just trying to figure out ways to get the crowd invested and make sure I was doing my job correctly, which means I would come out 99% of the time and go, come on, insert crowd name.
Oh, the classics. Get that. I still
do that to this day. Like, I'll come out and shout, come on, I need to change that. That's the one thing I need to change post-lockdown.
It's easy to do, though, because it's how everyone knows who the good guy is. I mean, not everyone's going to be an absolute nerd like I am, sitting in the second row going, well, I've heard this guy, he wrestles in Dundee and he's also done it here. and everyone else is going to be the exact same as it would be in the Ardler. They'll be going, oh, wrestler.
Yeah.
The good guy. He said, come on. Yes, he's the good guy. So he must be. The other guy looks mean. He must be the boo bad guy. I mean, from that point onwards, you have done a bit of traveling around there. So what made you settle in Source Wrestling from that point?
Well, I don't train at Source. I train at Reckless.
Oh, right. Well, screws up my notes. What made you settle at Reckless then for your training?
Sorry if I've screwed up the flow of
wrestling. No, it's fine. If you've listened to some of these, you know that I don't have any flow for these. I just kind of guess and hope for the best.
Well, I think we're Reckless. It was somewhere like I seen like a lot of people do really well in, and it was a place where I felt I can go there and I can become a much better version of myself. And I think it was a place like Stephen and Grum were wanting to go as well, and we all live in Perth, so it was easy enough just for us to jump in a car, share petrol, and go there. And it was like one of the best decisions I've, in terms of wrestling, it's one of the best decisions I've ever made because like being there has gave me a chance to become a much better wrestler than what I was in Dundee. It just gave me a chance to explore different stuff and do stuff that I never thought I would be capable of doing. It's like probably one of the best decisions I made.
I mean, Reckless really stepped up a lot over maybe a year after that they were kind of involved in Dundee, and then they just cut ties and they just went to new heights from that point onwards. Was it Michael Chase behind your training, or was there combination?
So Michael Chase took a couple of classes while I was there, but he was kind of more going to Delson Dare and Dickie at the time. But I think training under all those guys was something that really, really helped me. Because especially when I'll happily admit, when I was in Dundee for quite a bit of the time, I was quite cocky. Because I think within the promotion, a lot of people would just like big you up and be like, oh, you're the best, but you're in that bubble, so you don't realize that you're not really. So like going to Reckless kind of made me realize that I have still have a lot to learn, but I was able to learn it from some of the best people that could teach me it. Again, Michael Chase, who would blow you up instantly with all his drills and whatnot. And I think like just learning under them was really, really good for me. And Dickie as well, like in terms of like improving what I can do in the ring. Aspen as well, he's recently came in to be a trainer. I think he's kind of like especially helped me in terms of doing different stuff in matches and like opening my style to more different stuff.
Absolutely. I mean, in Divers and Aspen, actually, and Michael, they've pretty much seen just about everything in Scotland anyway, and even into across the UK. So if there's definitely a learning tree to go under, certainly it's the old adage of of seeing what your trainers have done. Because why would you train under someone who's only worked in one place and never done anything outside of it? How did you know they could actually do it?
Exactly.
Good.
Like, if you get someone that's like has so much experience, then it helps so much more because you learn as like so much more from that.
So from Reckless, you won your first and, as according to my records, and I'm blaming the Germans if I'm wrong, your only championship. It was the hardcore championship. I don't know if you kept a track of how long you held it for.
7 seconds.
Seven. I mean, does that include the three count?
Four.
Four seconds. I thought you were going to big up to 10 there. I was like, oh, double figures.
Oh, including the free count.
Yeah.
Oh, well, oh, but sorry, I thought you said excluding the free count. I was like, oh, no, including the free count. Yeah, it went up 10. Sorry.
That's fine. It doesn't count until the three count's made. It's still, the time counts up until that point.
As anyone will tell you, my title reign as a hardcore champion was absolutely legendary. I lifted the title up, got a great picture, got hoofed in the balls, and then I got pinned, as all the great legendary hardcore champions do.
Absolutely. Does that go in with the question that Hannah sent us? So Hannah is your partner, and she was very quick to put a question in to when I said you were coming onto the podcast, and she just put in capitals, ask him about when he broke his balls. When did that happen? Was that related? How? Tell me more.
Cast your mind back to 2018. I am 19 going on 20. And at the time, I started wanting to expand my horizons. I started training in a school in Glasgow. And at the time, it was like they did induction classes and whatnot. So obviously, I was in there with a different trip with lots of different people who didn't really... who this was like their first experience of wrestling. So there came to one class where they were doing crossbodies. And if you're doing a cross, and if you doing or like taking a crossbody, if you take it specifically, you can do like a scoop action, or you can do like most people would normally teach it, where you like put your hand between their legs and your other hand like underneath their head, and that's how you catch them. So I was given the crossbodies to some of these trainees. I was a trainee myself, and I went to give this one gent a crossbody, but I think he got a bit freaked out at this tall, fully grown adult running full pelt at him to give him a crossbody. So he kind of didn't want to take it properly. So he, instead of catching me, he just kind of folded his arms, so his elbows were pointing out. So I obviously came down, landed on my never reasoned on his elbow. And I was like, that doesn't feel too good. I didn't think much of it. I just felt like, it was a kick, a bit kick to the balls. It's fine. Then a couple of minutes later, I was like, right, I need to go get my train. Bear in mind, I live in Perth. Glasgow, probably about an hour and a half to an hour and 45 minutes away from Perth. So I go to the bathroom, check on myself. And the best way I can describe it is like you've put a melon to an orange.
Right.
Yeah. One of them was severely, severely swollen. And obviously, I see that. I'm like, oh no. I start freaking out. So I go to leave. I don't say anything. I start walking to the train station, which is like a 15-minute walk away. Bear in mind, I'm in very loose-fitting joggies as well. So I'm getting all kinds of look. Is he stealing fruit, that boy? Like, I'm getting all... So I'm still freaking out. So I phone Hannah, and it was like, I try and explain the situation. Because at this point, I think I'm going to lose one of them. So I phone Hannah. I'm nearly in tears. I phone her, and I'm like, this happened. Am I going to die? And Hannah just starts pissing herself down the end of the phone. She's laughing. She's like laughing hysterically. I'm nearly crying. So I hang up. I phone up the doctors, and obviously get myself a wee appointment there by the time I get back. So I go and get the train. I get some awkward looks from the conductor. I then get back into Perth, and I get a taxi up to PRI. I obviously have to phone my mum and explain the situation, which is fantastic experience for me to do. So I get there and I'm like, right, I'll get seen in like half an hour or so. Bear in mind, it's like 11 p.m. by the time I get there. I did not get seen until 3:30 in the morning.
Jesus.
To be fair though, it's like they did. It was a very busy night, and NHS is free, so I can't say anything.
Sorry, absolutely.
But by the time I do get seen, I'm obviously really wanting to get home and just get to my bed. So this is a long story, by the way.
Fine.
So I get checked up by the doctor, and he starts fondling me. And he's like, "How does injury occur?" And I was like, "Oh well, I was training to do wrestling in Glasgow," and he's like, "Oh, do you know Jack Chester?" And I'm like, so he was a fan. He was a big fan. He was a big fan. So I explained, yeah, that's how this happened. Not Jack Chester, that's not, you get the point. So he's like, "Oh yeah, that's cool." And then goes back, comes back, and he's like, "Yeah, we're gonna have to take you to Nine Wells." And I'm like, "I just want to go home." So I then get transferred to Nine Wells via ambulance, and I get put into a ward where I was the youngest there by about 50 years. And then, so I get a little bit of sleep at that point. I think I sleep from like seven till eight or something like that. And I get woken up by this huge muscular doctor. That doesn't have anything to do with the story, but just a massive guy. And he's like, "Right, we'll check you up. We have some student nurses here though. Can they be in for this?" And I'm like, "Do I have much of a choice?" So he starts again fondling my male genitalia. And has all these students sit there and start taking notes. Which is probably, looking back at it, is hilarious, but at the time I was mortified. So then I go and get like an ultrasound on them, which was again a horrific experience, and just to be told, "Oh yeah, it's just severe bruising, you can go home."
I mean, from my takeaway from that, at least the doctor knew about wrestling to start off with, so you didn't get that bit of embarrassment to go with it, for him to go wrestling.
Yeah, the first one did. Having to explain it to the second one, and they looked at me, and I was like, "Yeah, sure, whatever."
I cannot compare it to anything. I mean, when I broke my elbow in like three places, so I was really stupid. I thought I could jump off a child's roundabout, drunk. I couldn't, and I was way too old to be able to try. But yeah, I had the same thing with the students and all that kind of stuff, and they asked me, "Oh, how was it done?" And I went, "Well, I tried to jump off a roundabout. I failed, clearly." So here we go. Here it is.
I would have much preferred to tell that story than have what happened.
A man elbowed me in the genitals.
A good end to the story, though. Nothing was amputated, so it's all good.
There must be like a little split second we went, "We're going to take what? What are you going to take? What are you taking? What are you taking off? What?" Nine Wells. Oh, okay. Whew, <that's...
laughs> there was a bit of relief, but at the same time I was like, I just want to go home, because then I had to, obviously they didn't give me an ambulance back to Perth, I had to make my own way home. So that was an experience. Like that, injuring them, and I think I broke my pinky, which was nothing really too severe. Those are the two injuries I've had, and boy, what stories I've got to tell from them.
Thank you, Hannah, for putting that into the Twitter for us to hear about, because that, I don't think I'm going to get a better story in this round of recording. Lou did.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Well, the last recording I did was 2 days ago, and it was Lou recounting the time where 1,000 people in Aberdeen chant that he had a nugget penis. So, you know,
there's a common theme with all of this.
There really is. I mean, more than less than dinosaur chat recently, it's just all been about the genitals, and it's not testicle, guys. Let's just move on with the story. Right, okay. So that happened. You're reckless. I don't know how to move on from this. So that kind of opened, I'm assuming that would have opened your door, the door with Source then, because they kind of work quite closely with each other. Of course, Divers came from Source as well. So where did the team with Stephen Miles come from then, the Fair City Saints?
Well, I think when me and Stephen started, we always kind of talked about we'd like to do a tag team. Just because I feel like we know each other really well. Like he's my wrestling dad, as I always call him, even though he is only about 3 years older than me. but he's one of my best friends in wrestling. And I think just being able to do a tag team with him was something that we both kind of really want to do. Me more so than him, I think. I think we kind of got given, in our very first match with Reckless, second match even, we did a fatal, an elimination fatal four-way with Rob Mills and Theodorus. And in the match, we kind of got to show some double team stuff that we did. Again, it was just kind of coincidental. Oh, these two are in the same match and they're working together. Then we end up hitting each other, as most wrestlers do. But I think the Booker seen that and was like, you two can maybe work together and kind of get something from that. And I think it just kind of snowballed from there. I think me and Steven's dynamic really works really well. Well, I say that, but I'm the one that gets beat up most of the time, and he comes in and does all this big flippy stuff, and I'm like, cheers.
So from that point onwards, of course, you teamed a little bit in Reckless. I think when I was looking at the German site, you end up facing each other as well, and in between the interim of that, I suppose, just in the what's the word, nucleus of the Fair City Saints. That's not the word, but the first word that came into my head. I thought that's not right either.
I think we did a match at probably a gala day, and it was just it was a really fun experience because it was two tag team partners, but again the crowd didn't really care that we were tag team partners. They just want to see some wrestling, so we just kind of did all the kind of cool stuff that we like to do with each other. Again, I always like working with Steven. He's easy to work with, just does anything. So it's all good stuff.
So, officially came a team, and then you started challenging, obviously, for the Reckless 10 tag titles. Unfortunately, hasn't been successful as yet. Then you are entered in the Source Tag Team Tournament, which hasn't really went anywhere just yet.
Yeah.
But one of the matches I wanted to kind of pick up was you guys against More Than Hype. What were your thoughts going into that?
Going into it, I was really, really excited. I think you can tell in the promos that I was like, big, get to wrestle some big names from OTT. I was really looking forward to it. And the guys like Darren and Nathan are lovely, lovely guys. Like they're so easy to work with and so easy to get along with. I think for me, as I've said previously, like I'm my own worst critic. So I think looking back at that match, I'm always like, oh, I could have done so much more here, so much more there. And I think that I'm going to be like that with everything, because you can never really look at a match and be like, that's perfect. I feel like you always want to pick up like what you could improve upon. But I think for me, I take that to the ninth degree, and I'm always like, that could have been better, that could have been better. I think Hannah gets sick of me as well, because I'm always like, did you notice my eye contact at a split nanosecond here? And she's like, no. That's how I am. But I really enjoyed working with them, and it's a great experience for me. Unfortunately, they did kick us out of the tag team tournament, so I will never forgive them for that. But I really enjoyed working with them.
Am I right in thinking it was in Govan? Am I totally making
yes,
that?
Yes, you are.
Right. So I've spoken to guys like Grant McIver and ADM, and I've just got to mention again, the Govan crowd is one of the most insane crowds I've ever seen.
That was my first experience of the Govan crowd, and nothing could have prepared me, because it was booked as like a face versus face. Darren and Nathan went out first, and they got the crowd up. So when me and Stephen came out, they always like they're the bad guys. We got booed out of the building, and I was like, oh no, how do I deal with this? there's literally like a pyramid of just toddlers giving me the finger as I'm walking around, and Stephen comes around and I'm like, Dad, help me. So I give him a hug and I'm like, what's going on? I feel like throughout the match I'm like trying to be a bit more heelish, but I think just from like I feel like again that's something I need to work on, just kind of like adjusting to how the crowd's what the crowd's giving me, and like working on the fly to how the crowd's responding to the match.
I mean, you're dicing with death coming out in orange to start off with.
Oh, I didn't think about that. Stephen came up with a gear. I had nothing to do with that, so. Blame him.
So was there any inspiration, I mean, of course, Fair City, Perth, but was there any inspiration behind the Fair City Saints name?
I can remember when Stephen came up with a name, but I can remember we were sitting in the hospital. There's a common theme with me, but it wasn't for me. It was Grum had broke his, I think he broke his nose or something during the Reckless Rumble. So obviously we had to take him to, after the show, we had to take him to PRI to get his nose like realigned. And I think when he went away, me and Stephen were just kind of speaking about different names we could use, what we could use going forward. And I think Stephen like started thinking of like different stuff to do with like Fair City. And it was like, what about the Fair City Saints? And it kind of gave it to two reasons. Like one is the local football teams, like the Saints, so that kind of went hand in hand. But also I'm a massive CM Punk fan, as anyone will tell you. I think it was like, I can't remember the name of his tag team with Colt Cabana, but
the Second City Saints or something.
Second
like that.
City Saints, that was it. So I think we kind of took that and was like, that could be actually really cool. And that's the genesis of Fair City Saints. And to be honest, I didn't really like it that much to begin with, but I feel like as the response it's gotten, a lot of people do like it, so I have grown to love it now.
Just when you're speaking about your relationship with Stephen, I've just got, because we spoke about Spider-Man before we hit record, I've just got that meme in my head of Peter Parker and Miles Morales from Spider-Verse, and you in the like the toy gear behind him, yeah. just going, yeah, yeah, just yeah, listening.
Well, he like he's like tried to be like, right, you need like because he does a lot of like big kind of flashy moves like 450, Topic on Hilo, like a springboard Enzi. And I feel like I do some stuff, but not as extravagant to the extent that Stephen does it. And he's always kind of like trying to push me to do more stuff. So hopefully when more stuff in the vein that he does. So hopefully when lockdown is hopefully moved away in a distant memory, I can try and again evolve my style to implement more kind of high flying aspects. But yeah, definitely that meme is definitely me and Steven's dynamic.
Now you could be the Fair City Machine Guns instead, and you can just do all the cool tag names, tag stuff.
I'm a massive fan of them as well, so fair enough.
So we'll move away from wrestling just for a second, because you're not only a wrestler, you're also doing all right on the YouTube. And this is good. This is when I sound like a real old person when I say things like the YouTube. So you do the video game reviews. You'll do a couple other things, because the first time I spotted your, what was it? Oh, it was starting a series, the Alex Webb or something like that.
Webb's World.
Excellent.
Oh, that video has been long privated. I think like as anyone who like does YouTube will tell you, like, your first videos will be bad. Like, I get like it's like you don't really know what you're doing, and you'll look back at it and be like, that's really cringy. Why did I do that? And I think it's the same for me when I watch back like Webb's Old or anything, because it was just me trying to be like being the elite. It was me just trying to emulate the Young Bucks and what they were doing. I didn't know anything. I didn't know anything about editing, sound design, and how to make everything kind of mesh well together, I want to say. Yeah, no, it was watching that back. You can see like sparks and stuff, but no, it's a horrible, horrible video.
As someone who did a web series called Ask Billy on YouTube, where I edited it and recorded it on a PS3, I absolutely understand all of that. And I
on the PS3?
Yeah, I did all my editing. I create and uploaded it from there as well. And they have long disappeared because it was just so bad. And
I rate the try though on the PS3 especially. Like,
fair I didn't enough. Have a laptop. I had to do it on the PS3. I didn't have to do it. Nobody had to see them. But yeah, it was a very interesting time. I had an eye camera, I create, and just did everything on there, including downloading clips, putting them from sources on the web browser. It was a lot of work for not a lot of views. But so you started with Webb's World. I really enjoyed it because I contacted you not long after it went out and went, can I put it on my site? It's gone, by the way. You're safe. It's definitely off the site.
Lovely. Thank God.
But what were you decide to move on from Webb's World, which, you know, tough loss for us, to doing the video game reviews?
Well, as I said at the very start of this, I really, really like video games, as most people do. But I feel like, for me, I've got like a real passion for like game, like wrestling video games, especially, and like Spider-Man games as well. I can't get rid of Spider-Man. He's always there. But like, I've got like a big passion for stuff like that. And I feel like I was kind of just like with YouTube, as you said, like I was doing stuff and I was like, why is this not getting any views? And I was like, I kind of realized that it wasn't really that good. And it wasn't because like a lot of people do like, what I started doing was it was like playthroughs of games. So I would like play a game, I would have my audio over the top and then I would cut it up and I would put it, post it on my YouTube, and I would get like 40 views, give or take, in like a month or so. And I would be like, oh, why is this not getting any views? And so I kind of like sat back and I started like thinking, what do I actually want to make? And a YouTube video is a lot like a wrestling match in a way, because you've got to have a start and a finish, and you've got to kind of keep your audience invested throughout and figure out ways to keep them invested. And I think that's where kind of reviewing games and giving my own kind of thoughts and opinions kind of came from, because that allowed me to script out videos and allowed me to kind of evolve my editing and put like jokes in there as well. And I think that kind of started working a lot more for me. And I think it's kind of evolved from there, and just me kind of being stupid about video games and putting in far too many memes. And that's how my YouTube's has evolved.
There's anyone who hasn't watched them, which I'd be surprised. I'm just going to move someone up on my little podium here, just because we're speaking about him now. We have a little Spider-Man here, both of them.
Oh, wait a minute. I'll just pop him here as well.
Yeah. So I've got an Iron Spider here as well, which I put back in the box because it looks prettier in the box. And I've lost. I took all the rest of them out of the box, thinking, "Oh, I'll just display them. I'll never want to put them back in the box or anything." But now I want to, and I've got rid of all the boxes. So
that's
super annoying. Anyway, right. So the ones that obviously caught my attention would have been the wrestling ones, because I'm a big wrestling nerd. And they're really slick. How long does it take you generally to put one together?
The first, like, if you're like, I feel like my videos have kind of like, but I add more stuff in now, so it takes me a lot longer to just get them edited. So like, say the recent Spider-Man one I did, I think back in December, it was me looking at the Spider-Man PS4 game, and that one took, I want to say, like about a month to do, like just from terms of scripting it and editing it. I think again, if I didn't have other stuff on, like obviously I've got my college stuff course to do as well, because that's like final year of that, so I can need to get stuff done for that as well. But mostly it takes about a month or a bit more to get done. My first ones probably took about 3 weeks or so, but like now they take about like a month or so to get done, because I'm far too pernickety with how stuff looks, and I'm like, oh, there needs to be a joke there. There needs to be a meme there to keep the audience engaged and keep them watching throughout.
They absolutely are slick productions. And is there any particular reason you choose a game at a time, or is it just one you've been playing and go, oh, I could do something about this? You did the backyard wrestling games as well.
Fantastic games those are. But no, like, I think it's just stuff that is like, I think could work well with what I'm currently doing. So like say a lot of my viewers typically like wrestling stuff and wrestling games, because a lot of them come from, I think my biggest video at the time is currently just now is, it's either a video I did reviewing the TNA Impact game or comparing Here Comes the Pain to 2K19. Sorry, excuse me. And I think they are all like that because both of them have about 50K each. So I think if, like they've all my kind of viewers have flocked from there, or at least a huge majority of them. So I think I kind of thought, right, if I want to kind of keep them around, make sure they don't unsubscribe, I'll keep on pushing out more wrestling content, because again, that's the content they want to watch. But I'll also intersperse it with stuff that I really like. So I think I wanted to do a video on Saints Row 3 because the remaster just came out. So I did a video on that. I've always wanted to do videos on Spider-Man games because I've got most of them. So like I want to do one on Web of Shadows, both the amazing Spider-Man games. I want to do Spider-Man 2 versus Ultimate Spider-Man, see which one's better from that. But again, I've also got different ideas for like I want to do the Arkham series as well. Just looking at different, I guess it's pretty much just like superhero type video games and wrestling type video games is the stuff that I would like to do and like to focus on. But it's not really stuff I'm playing. It's just like, yeah, that would work well. I want to do a video on that. Or I'm like, I've got a really funny joke I can put at 1 second in this video. Let's make a whole 20-minute video out of it.
Your one on 2K20 was a particular revelation, saying as that was my kind of first foray during this lockdown period of what am I going to do? I'll play 2K20. I'll do that on Twitch. Oh, wow. Absolutely.
I did appreciate the creator wrestler you made of me though. It's very accurate apart from the fact I do not have a six pack. So, but no, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah, no, I'd same issue with yourself as I did with Emily Hayden with getting a face, because unfortunately in your pictures you like to smile a lot, and 2K20 doesn't like that. So I was spending most of my time just every time you put up, not to be a stalker, but every time you like a new photo had come up on like your fan page or something like that, I'd go, can I use it? Yes, take that one. Gone.
Fair enough. I typically don't like, when it comes to photos, I don't like to take them too seriously. Most of them will either be wrestling ones where my fringe is back and you can see my hairline going back to the top of my head, or or it's just me making a goofy expression, as all my roommate hates it. The rose picture of me like that, because I use that for every video and he absolutely hates it because he's seen it way too much.
And it was almost used for this thumbnail as well.
Well, I think if you're promoting me as a wrestler, it's probably not the best idea to go, this guy.
That's what I thought. I wasn't even gonna ask you, I was just gonna do it, and I thought maybe I should just make sure he's got a wrestling one before I do it.
If you put it up, I wouldn't mind it. Like I don't tend to take stuff too seriously, so it's fine.
So you've mentioned several times, and I've mentioned it as well, yeah, you have quite a love for Spider-Man. What began that love for Spider-Man?
Was it Tobey Maguire and his beautiful, beautiful face? No, I think as anyone, I started watching like the 90s, like reruns of the 90s animated cartoon. And
best theme tune ever for a cartoon, in my opinion.
Which one would you say has the best?
X-Men animated series.
Yeah, fair, very fair. I would have said like the best Spider-Man one is the Spectacular Spider-Man series. If you've not listened to that, I would urge you to go and listen to that, because like it's a bop.
Writing it down. There we go.
But also the full series is on Netflix, just if you want to go watch that as well. But I think what really kind of reaffirmed my love for Spider-Man was watching the Sam Raimi trilogy. As a kid, I didn't really appreciate the films that much, but I seen Spider-Man was like, oh my god, this is so cool, because it was actually him swinging around and it was in real life. Although I think as a kid, I was scared of a lot of stuff. Quite a wimpy kid, I would say. But I remember seeing like the spikes come out of his like finger. You know, like in the first film, it zooms into his thumb, and you see like the little prickles come out of his finger that allow him to like crawl up the wall. Yeah, that freaked me out as a kid. I mind I would look at my hand and be like, "There's nothing coming out, is there?" No, but like I love the films, all three of them to be precise, because the third one is a masterpiece and I will not hear otherwise.
I will argue with you. I the only Spider-Man film I don't like is Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Yeah, fully agree. But no, I absolutely adore the Sam Raimi trilogy, and I think I rewatched them recently, and I think that kind of made me love them even more, because like just from a film perspective, like the way everything's shot and like how he kind of Sam brings in his like horror film esque roots to it. So like he did the Evil Dead beforehand, and like there's so many scenes in like his trilogy where you can kind of see that in the films. Like the biggest one that comes to mind is the Dr. Octopus scene where he like wakes up in the infirmary and they're trying to like cut off his arms, and his arms just go absolutely mental, murking everyone in the room. But no, I absolutely adore all the films, and I just think that just the memes that I can make from it are definitely a highlight. But also from a filmmaking aspect, like I just love the interpretation of Peter Parker. It is a bit hard to see that Peter Parker as like a cool talking Spider-Man, but I get that interpretation of the character is like a lot different from what like he would be in like the comics and stuff like that, and I'm all open to that. Also, I will hold this to this day, still the best looking like symbiote like Venom effects in the third one, because in the actual Venom film, like and that came out in 2018, horrible effects. Sam Raimi's Spider-Man 3 looks so much better.
I watched Venom quite recently for the first time, and I was like, I like Tom Hardy, I like that. That's it. I watched the film and went, no, I like Tom Hardy as Venom. I'm all in for that, but the rest of the film could go. I just think
that film, they didn't really know what they wanted to do. Like, I feel like most people are like, right, we have alien slime, what do we do with it? Like, and I feel like not a lot of people really know how to handle that character, especially when you make a solo film about him and you don't have Spider-Man in the film, who's such an integral character to Venom.
Pretty much, yeah. It's like, oh, what we could do? Well, Spider-Man, no, we can't do that.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
okay.
I just think it was a total mess and it was missing aspects. A lot of people would be like, oh, it was like an R rating, it would have been better. And like, sure, there would have been aspects that would have been better, but I still feel like the film wouldn't have been that good.
I had a run of bad films with that because I watched Spider-Man 2, which has just, oh god, it just didn't go anywhere, and then when it did, it ended. The same with Batman v Superman, which started before it finished.
And it was I remember watching Batman vs Superman. Sorry, I mean, I cut you off straight away. There.
That's fine.
I remember watching Batman vs Superman in the cinema. I was like, oh, this is all right. This is not bad. Then about half an hour later, I was like, yeah, this is all right. And then it gets to the point where Bruce's, where Superman's like, we have to get to Martha. And Batman's like, why did you say that name? And I'm like, you've lost me. You've fully lost me.
Oh, I was just like, I was like watching it going, yeah, I still haven't seen the last 10 minutes of it because I had a pirated copy and it cut off before the end. So I still haven't seen the end of it. So the ending could be incredible. But I was just watching it going, all right, okay, I'm getting this. They're all coming together. Let me think of Justice League. Oh, either way, it doesn't matter. It's all the same. It was like, oh, it's all getting together. It's all going, who's that guy? And Darkseid turned up.
Yeah.
Where did he come from?
That was Justice League, I'm pretty sure. I haven't seen Justice League, but... oh, no, wait. Doomsday was in Batman versus Superman.
Something Bane, not Wolfsbane. That's Harry Potter.
Big grey villain, as most superhero films tend to have these days.
Obviously, yeah. Oh, it's good. Bug me now. Not enough for me to Google it. But yeah, so yeah, DC films generally, other than Shazam, is the only one I've liked out of that lot so far. So I'll go back to Spider-Man. Spider-Man's way more fun. So what are your thoughts then, Sam Raimi doing Doctor Strange?
It's very, very interesting. I hope that, like, because I feel like I do like a lot of the Marvel films, but I feel like stylistically, Sam Raimi has like such a unique way of making a film and shooting it and putting it together. Like him and Edgar Wright are some of my favorite directors, just because the way they edit stuff together and how they make the most mundane things seem interesting is like really, really fascinating to watch. But I feel like I hope him making the film, he gets to make a Sam Raimi film instead of a Disney Marvel film, if that makes sense, because they're all kind of like, I feel like all the Marvel films stylistically are like kind of meshed together for me. Like, if you showed me a frame from like the first Iron Man film, and then you showed me a frame from Infinity War, I'd be like, oh, one looks better, but I would still think they're like somewhat in the same film, somewhat the same film. I don't know.
I think they've learned to take chances with things like Guardians of the Galaxy, because it was very different. Now they're all kind of the same from that point onwards, but that was kind of the first tonal shift, I think, in style.
I think, Guardians of the Galaxy definitely, in terms of like how it's shot, how it looks, was such like a drastic departure from what they were doing. I was like, oh, this looks really cool. So, yeah, like, I get what you're saying.
Yeah. Have you watched WandaVision at all?
I haven't, actually. I do need to get around to watching it, but I was just going to wait for it to all come out in one block, and then I would watch it.
Okay, that's fine. I think I'll help you with your... If you have any concerns about a multiverse thing, I think WandaVision might help and might make it all worse for you. I don't know, but... it's incredible. I'm watching it weekly, and I even had to take a slightly extended lunch break because I had to watch it on Friday during the day, so I could go online, because Twitter is a barren hive of scum and villainy that'll tell you what happens.
It's difficult to like not get any spoilers for anything when it comes to like films or TV shows or even games on Twitter, so I kind of stay off that most of the time.
Horrible place. Right, so we'll go back to the fan questions then. Otherwise, we will just speak about Spider-Man for the next hour. Aspen has commented, you've probably seen a lot of these already, but if you don't go on Twitter that much, you may be saved and not see many. Aspen's asked why I'm such an inspiration to him.
Well, I don't know how to answer this with a joke, so I'm just going to answer it honestly. I feel like in terms of wrestling, I don't know, I don't think Aspen realizes this, but he has helped me a hell of a lot in terms of like coming out of my shell and not staying in my comfort zone. Like, he's like, he offers like moves and sequences that I can do, and it really kind of helps me like build up my confidence, one, within the ring, but it also helps me like craft my own kind of style of it. And also I think in terms of like Photoshop and editing, like he's like a masterclass at Photoshop. I would like to think I've gotten pegged for editing, but it's constant like competition between that.
Aspen, he'll know this if he's listening to this, but he's one of my favorite wrestlers ever at this moment in time. I think I've said that countless times, that he doesn't need to hear me say it again. But he has, if he is listening. He's just one of those guys. He's the only guy who's made me cry at a wrestling show, and he's just one of those guys that just could do just about everything, but doesn't seem to know he can do it. He's just very nonchalantly good at everything, which I can see why people hate him when he's a heel, because he's just so bloody good. Anyway, right, that's the Aspen love over. Ian Skinner, we're into the meme section of this part. He's put, ask him what's better. He's going to expect me to do an impression of all these as well.
To your best ability.
Okay.
To your best ability.
I'm so glad that my wife is not here to hear me do this out loud. My name is Jeff. My wife, and I'm not doing that last one, longest yeah boy ever. What's better?
See, he's gave me the most difficult question I could possibly answer, because they're all god tier. They're all so good. But I think bruh just pitches them at the post. I think bruh is top tier, and I've used it in my videos, so I have to say it's the best, because that's probably top tier meme. For my birthday, Ian did message me a video saying, I'm going to give you what you deserve, and he just said bruh down the mic, so you know, I have to say that now.
That sounds like such an Ian Skinner thing to do. And I've got him coming up next month. I'm interviewing him for part two of our chat. And I'm going to have to really do some meme research, because I was so lost last time I spoke to him about it. It's the award for the best podcast in season one. It's just me going, I don't know what you're saying, Ian.
I will say, Ian has a lot better meme knowledge than I do. Like, he messaged me out of the blue, like, at the start of lockdown, like, saying, oh, I like your videos, and then we just kept on, like, sending memes to each other, and that's how a beautiful friendship was formed.
There's stranger ways to create friendship, so I can just imagine I'm just in the dead of night with a little, like, trench coat, got any of them memes, and what's the new meme on the street?
Just no, like
he's open, young, he wouldn't say that.
opens up coat with a ton of different like PNG images, like
that's it. Yeah. So Marlon, he didn't really have a question, but he did reply to it, but I just wanted to read it out anyway. He just wanted to let you know that your videos are helping him finish his essays. It's on a repeat playlist with Austin Eruption and thank you. Now you said it. And that's obviously how it's said, Cadigris, yeah. An Austin Eruption. So he really enjoys your video content that he puts out. So is it weird getting those that feedback?
It's weird in general seeing people enjoying it. Like for most of my time on social media, I've never been like a kind of big popular person, and like it's kind of weird to see more people like kind of find my videos and comment, oh, this guy's like really funny, or this guy's editing's really good, or like this video is like helping me get through something. Because I'm just like, to be honest, I'm just making videos that I find funny and that I like to make, because I like typically I don't think I'm that funny. So to see people be like, oh, I was laughing all the way through this, or like I really enjoyed this video, it's really, really weird. It's nice, don't get me wrong, it's lovely to see, but it's so weird to see that kind of interaction with my stuff.
I do remember Hannah constantly tweeting that she's been trying to get you onto Twitter. So I'm glad she did, because then that's kind of how I properly discovered your stuff anyway.
Yeah. Funny you should mention that. Hannah didn't get me onto Twitter. I was bullied onto Twitter by Stephen and Grum and Kwaku, for that matter. Because I think it was just because I did a podcast with Kwaku breaking down like the Source tag team tournament, and I just wanted to interview every like tag team in the competition. And I think afterwards Kwaku was like, you need to get a Twitter. And I was like, because at the time I was like, it's a pain in the arse to build up a following on Twitter. But I think it's done me a world of good, but I was bullied into it by Stephen and Grum. As we're sitting, I think it was in McDonald's of all places, sitting at McDonald's, as Grum and Stephen would not let me leave until I made a Twitter. So I made it, and I got a message from Hannah about 2 minutes later saying, oh, so you'll make one when Stephen asks you, but not when I ask you.
Well, if your dad asks you to do something, you're more likely to do it. That's just the way the world works.
No, I was forced into Twitter, but to be fair, it's done me a world of good. I've been able to like reach out to more people and like interact with more people. And it's a different platform to obviously promote my stuff, so it's all good.
I just find it a lot easier nowadays. I've still got the Facebook, and ironically enough, the videos that I put out get more views on Facebook, but I don't use Facebook. I use Twitter for everything now. I just find it easier. I can mute people, and it's great. I don't have to see them speak ever again. But that's just because I'm antisocial and don't. This is my social time over Zoom. Not face-to-face with anyone.
Great. Fair enough.
So Grant McIver, he's got quite a few technical questions about your gaming. How many platinum trophies do you have?
Off the top of my head, I've got a platinum trophy for Uncharted 2, I want to say. One for Spider-Man PS4, because of course I do. All the Telltale games, but again, they're easy to get a platinum trophy on. I'm looking behind me to look at the games I've got there just to see which ones. The Outer Worlds, I have a platinum trophy for as well. And I want to say that's about it, because I was on Xbox until PS4. So
yeah, I think I've got like 55 last checked, but a lot of them are really rubbish games or Lego, because I love the Lego games.
I tend to like, if it's a game that I really enjoy, I'll platinum it. But most of the time, I cannot be arsed doing all like the little like, oh, go collect 500 newspapers, and I'm like, no, I don't want to do that.
But yeah, my platinums look really good because I've played Lego games from the PS3, PS4, Vita, all that kind of stuff. And yeah, Ratchet and Clank, I'm trying to get the last couple in because I've got everything. It's just really stupid ones like complete a race and under this time. And I'm like, I'm rubbish at racing games.
Like, it's all like the tiny little insignificant things I don't want to do. I'm like, you've taken my money. I've enjoyed the game. Don't make me do anything else.
Absolutely. And then and if you do something like Spyro, the Reignited Trilogy, that annoyed me because I finished the game. Great. Check my trophy list. 23%. No. Finished it. Let me finish it. No, you have to do this level. No, I don't want to. Don't like them either. The stupid flying ones. Nah, can't do it. Flying and racing. I can get rid of them from all games. He's also asked most hated video game level.
This isn't from like a bad game per se, but like to platinum Uncharted 2, you have to play it on like crushing and brutal difficulty. Now, I don't know if you remember, but there's a train mission where you have to like scale up the train and you have to shoot people and whatnot. And
oh, God,
I was there for 2 hours trying to get past that mission, because you die in like 2 hits, and I don't typically rage that much, but I nearly needed a new controller at the end of it. Like, I was pulling my hair out, which is bad because I don't have a lot left. So,
Man, I round about the start of lockdown when PS4 or PlayStation were nice enough to put out the Uncharted trilogy for free.
Yeah.
I played through the first one again and I absolutely loved it. And I was going to run it through on like the hardest difficulty, and I got about three levels in. And went, nah. No, it's not fun for me anymore. I'm just going to the second one.
It's either that or a friend dared me to play Alien Isolation on the hardest difficulty. And apparently I hate myself because I did it. And it took me about 20 hours to beat it because, like, on that difficulty, the alien has about a sixth sense because it catches you like that. And I was gone most of the time.
Jesus.
And plus, I don't handle well with horror games. So that thing creeping up on me all the time was not a pleasant experience.
Yeah, I'll avoid it. I played Fallout New Vegas, maybe, I think it was. Went into a bit. Something screamed at me and jumped on me. And I thought, control it down.
Yeah,
that's not getting played anymore. And thankfully, I borrowed it, so I'd like, it's not mine. I haven't lost money out of this. I know I don't do horror games at all. It's also asked favorite. I'm surprised how good this is. Game.
I'm actually going to go with. I did a video on Rumble Roses, and I expected that game. Like, if you've looked at that game, it's just how can I put this in a PG way? It's very sexual. It's just it's a full game with just fully women wrestlers, but it's so over-sexualized. And I was like, I thought this was just going to be the most misogynistic game I've ever played. And to an extent, it was. But in terms of gameplay, it actually played really well. I'm sitting here like, I'm not going mental, am I? Am I enjoying the big anime girl game? What's going on here?
I had that. I had to buy it covertly when the game used to have the game station. I actually used to have like the 4 for £10. I spotted it. I had to put in like a stack of games so I didn't look like a pervert.
I was staying with my mum at the time, and the game arrived. For some reason, she took it upon herself to open up the mail, and that's the only time she's ever done it. And
she knew
and found the game. So when I came home, she was like, oh, your PS2 game arrived, Liam. I'm like, what one, mother? And she's like, you know what one? Nah, my mom's sound, she didn't really care that much, but it was still funny to see.
It's like she must have picked up and went, I sense I need to open this.
I think like the package was somewhat see-through, so she's seen what I'm assuming was something quite sexual, so
just a faint outline of a breast, and no, I need to know what this is. I'll have that filth in my house. And he finally asked, best tactic for getting gift subs.
I think he's got...
To me, when I read that, I just think, do people get free Subways? How? Anyway,
I think he thinks because gift subs is a Twitch thing. Subs on YouTube is just like people will subscribe. Gift subs is like something someone will give to someone. So you get like, in a Twitch stream, if someone like gives you a sub, then that's like you're giving the person money as well. You're giving like the streamer money as well. I'm not too sure. My roommate does streaming as well, so he'd be better asked than I would. But in terms of YouTube and getting subs, like, it's difficult because I still don't really know. Because recently, like, I've been getting like 1,000 subs per every 10 days because one of my videos has just started to get rank abandoned more. But in terms of getting subs, it's just make content you're like passionate about. Just make videos you're happy with. Like, that's the best thing I can say, and just constantly improve what you're doing. And then people will see that, see the effort you're putting into it, and then they'll subscribe to you. Because if you make bad videos or like low quality videos, someone will see that and be like, I don't want to bother with this. But if you make like something someone will engage with and something someone will be like, oh, I really like that, I want to see more from him, that's the best way to get subscribers, or at least that's how I've got subscribers.
Yeah, that's a good answer. Yeah, so I don't know, my subs have kind of sat the same for a wee while. Occasionally a couple will come in, but I suppose, I mean, my content is it's a niche because it's wrestling.
Yeah.
It's a niche within a niche because it's Scottish wrestling. So that's, actually no, the niche within it is British, then the niche within that is Scottish, and then I'm not interviewing the guys that are on NXT UK and that, so it's not like I'm speaking to...
But, like, I've always appreciated, like, SWN because you give, like, smaller wrestlers, like, guys like me, Ian Skinner, Umar Muhammad, like, you give people who don't necessarily have that, like, as big a reputation as some guys are on NXT UK, and you let them, like, give them a chance to, like, speak and, like, give their opinions and whatnot, and just promote them as a wrestler, so it gives a really good opportunity to, like, younger guys on the scene. So I've always appreciated you for that.
That's what it's here for. I mean, I'm just, well, otherwise I'm just rattling about the hoops by myself, so I'll be able to do something. And this is what I've ended up doing, which could be good or bad, depending on who's watching. So Alistair Adams asked, why do you like getting larated by him so much?
There's a very, very simple answer to that. I don't. Nah, but like in terms of working with Alistair, like I feel like he's probably one of the main people when lockdown's over, when and if, I want to get in the ring with Alistair and have a singles match with him. Because I feel like anytime we have like a training match or anytime like we speak about wrestling, I feel like we bounce ideas off each other, and I feel like we could really do something quite special. I would just like, maybe saying something special is a bit over the top, but like we could put on a good match effectively. And I feel like it would be, he's one of the guys I'd really like to get in the ring with. I feel like it would be a really fun experience besides getting hit with a lariat.
And we've got Shinaku has asked a bunch of questions as well. What other games do you like playing? So outside of wrestling and Spider-Man, we'll go with.
At the moment, through YouTube, I managed to get in contact with, have you ever heard of Journey of Wrestling?
Oh yeah, OSW Review did a bit on it recently.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Well, they seen my video on SmackDown versus Raw, and the developer gave me said, oh, he liked it and wanted to offer me a key for it. So he got in contact with me, and I was like, yeah, sure, man, I'd love to do it. Hopefully, I could get around to making a video on it. And he was like, oh yeah, that would be great, man. Just giving me your feedback on it. So he gave me a key, and I've been addicted to that game for about a week now. I'm booking AEW versus WWE, New Japan, Impact. Orange Cassidy is my world champion. Zack Sabre Jr. is my TNT champion. So no, I'm having fun with that.
I do like the look of it, so I think I might try and give it a go at some point. They've also asked, how did you get started in the wrestling business? But we've covered that one. Do you watch the Dark Side of the Ring documentary series?
I do watch it, but I have to be in the mood for it because it is so depressing from time to time. Like, if I'm in the mood to listen to murder stories or listen to how seedy the wrestling business can be, I'll watch it. But if I want something a bit more light, maybe stay away from it.
I know, I've tried to watch it, but what kind of spoils it for me is how it's, like, interviews and that's great, it's not a great subject, all that kind of thing, but where they do the smoky bits with the actors in the background, yeah, yeah, pretend, I look at it and go, that looks awful, I can't, I can't watch this anymore.
I don't mind that bit, but like I feel like if it's a really interesting story, so say like the first two episodes of season two, I don't know if I'm allowed to say his name, but it was on a very specific wrestler who murdered people.
That's not narrowing it down, sadly.
Oh my god, it's not as well. People who've watched it know who it is. I'm not going to spoil it. But like, it was really interesting to see like leading up to his death and after his death and all the fallout from that and what happened with the business. Also, just like watching stuff to do with New Jack is always interesting to me because that man is a fever dream of a human being. You look at his Twitter and it's like ramblings. It's like his ramblings, which have been mixed with a cocktail of LSD, cocaine, and massive brain trauma. Like, he's a human cocktail of a man. I do not know what to make of him, but his Twitter is hilariously good to look at.
And he's got Cameo. That's a dangerous combination.
Oh, I might just ask for Cameo, like, now that you've mentioned that.
Kwaku, he didn't really ask anything, but ask you about your YouTube channel, because you're a popular dude. We've done that, so that's fine. Dean Ford asked...
Before we talk about Dean Ford, like, I feel like with Kwaku, like, he's kind of brought in a lot more of my YouTube into my wrestling persona, which when lockdown's over, I kind of want to implement more into, because everyone knows I do it. Everyone knows that I'm quite passionate about it, so I feel like it'd be good to kind of implement that into my character. I've got a couple of nicknames in mind. I'm not gonna put it out here in case they get stolen. No, I'm kidding. But like, I kind of really want to implement more because he was the one that came up with the idea to like, anytime I come out, he does weighing in at how many subscribers do I have at the moment? Like weighing in at 3,000 subscribers, Alex Webb,
and I'm like,
that's so cool. So like, thanks to him, I've kind of like been able to implement more of my YouTube into my wrestling persona. So obviously when lockdown's over, I will hopefully get to mix and match more often.
Absolutely. I mean, hopefully, because Zach Ryder has recently just started a podcast going on about his true Long Island story. So hopefully you got a bit more success than he did, and maybe a bit more Xavier Woods kind of standing.
I mean, to be fair, Zach Ryder did do quite well with YouTube until he gave it to WWE, and Vince was like, nah, we're just going to put it in the bin. Lol.
Well, we'll put you in the bin as well.
And now we're going to push you off the stage in a wheelchair.
Oh, what a time to be alive to see that. That was just, yeah, but I've just started listening to that, and it's pretty much it. He went, I got a camera for Christmas. That was it. He started it. So, you know, it works for everyone. But yeah, the likes of nowadays, especially, you see up, down, down, and all that kind of thing. So YouTube is a very lucrative market to have. And nobody in Scotland, I don't think, really has it as part of their wrestling character so much. So it's definitely a unique thing for you to bring in.
I don't want to start doing it until I feel like my like audience is big enough that I can start implementing it into my character. I feel like I'm getting there, but at the same time, I want to be able to like say, like, I have this amount of people, and that's kind of like something that can bring forth a different dimension to my character. Like, I've got this amount of people watching me. If say I was a heel, I've got this amount of people watching me. Who do you have? Like, stuff like that. Or maybe just start looking at Logan Paul and Jake Paul and be like, they're arseholes. How can I make myself an arsehole? You know?
Or just go down the paparazzi productions method, come out with the camera and Alex Shelley. Seeing as you're a fan of the machine guns, it just kind of works out perfectly. So Dean Ford did ask one of the more pressing questions, which is, I've got a feeling this is going to be a regular question now from now on. He's asked, what would win in a fight, one cow or two sheep?
That's a question that's rocked me to my core. I might need to take 5 minutes to think about that, honestly. Off the top of my head, I will say a cow. For the sheer fact that body mass alone, a cow could just fall on the sheep. Like, realistically.
True. I was of the opinion of a cow can go upstairs but can't go downstairs. So if the sheep somehow get it to go up somewhere and then kind of team and push it off a ledge.
What? Okay, of all the things I thought about speaking on this podcast, pushing a cow down the flight of stairs was not one of them.
This is the second time I've said this out loud, and now I've said it again, I'm like, this is the stupidest thing I've said ever. Two sheep team up to beat, have to team up together to beat a cow. The answer is a cow, but I'm still pulling for two sheep. I'm believing in them. Last one is our regular question, which is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, I was supposed to, I knew this was coming, and I was supposed to research it. Oh, no. I don't want to just be generic and see a T-Rex or Triceratops, but I want to go for one of the goofy ones, but I don't know what the goofy ones are called.
Well, like I said, I've said, people are listening to this going, I was going to tell his favorite ones, because I am. Turkey dinosaur is a favorite. Luchasaurus is also a favorite one that came up. And then you got your classics, your Triceratops, T-Rex, Ankylosaurus, Stegosaurus. I've just played Jurassic World recently, so I've got all of them in my head. Spinosaurus.
I'm 100% not looking it up at the moment.
just googled goofy dinosaurs. Barney?
Let's go with Barney the dinosaur. That's my favourite dinosaur.
Excellent. Right, so we'll just do one little bit more wrestling stuff, because I've had you on for quite a while now. So I'll do one more bit about wrestling, then we'll do socials, and then we can all go in and think about the sheep and cow situation.
That's going to keep me up at night, honestly. That's going to keep me up at night.
So I just wrote Discovery Wrestling down, and I'm going to use my power of just remembering. I to remember when you made your debut, and was it in the Reckless Raffle? Yeah, the most recent. It was good. Fine. Right. So that was all about the raffle event. I don't know how much they've given away, how it was set up, but when did you receive your ticket? What was your number for your ticket? What did you feel like when it was drawn? All the feelings, because Discovery is one of the big companies in the UK. So what was it like making your debut for them?
I think for me, going in, like, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but we had an idea what was going to happen beforehand. In terms of like with the raffle and whatnot, because we didn't come in with any specific, like, we didn't come in at like entrances. It's not like a Royal Rumble. We all started in the ring, and each one had a number, and then each number was given to a random person in the audience, and then that person would, if I won it, the person that had my ticket would have won a prize from the raffle.
Huh. That's cool.
Unfortunately, though, I didn't win it, because I got crucifix pile drivered and then thrown out the ring. So that was a pleasant experience. But on a real, like, I think for me, my wish list of like places I want to wrestle consistently, Discovery's top. Like, because Discovery for me, like, it's such a, like, a great atmosphere to even just be security at, because like everyone that goes there is so nice. The locker room's so lovely as well. And I feel like me and Steven could offer something as a tag team there. I just would really, really like to just get in there with some of the people that Discovery books. But no, Discovery is like the main one. I would also like to maybe potentially get a shot at WrestleZone or something like that. Those are on the wish list. But only time will tell.
Absolutely. That seems like a really good way to move into the last little bit. But on to the tag teams. I really hope once things go back to some sort of normality, as in for like mingling and crowds and what have you, they bring in a tag team division, because I think it's just something that would just because they've had so many great tag teams. They had Civil War a couple of years back as well, so I think the time's right maybe to get some Discovery Wrestling tag team championships in and about. So thank you for speaking to me today. I'm so glad that you have. Like I said beforehand, thought, oh, we'll stick here about an hour, and we're about an hour and a half in now. And
oh, lovely.
like I say, if we spoke about Spider-Man anymore, we'd be here much longer, but I'll leave you to have the rest of your day. So where can people find you on social media?
Well, it is, hang on, let me quickly check. On Facebook, it is I believe it's the Alex Webb, which I do need to change. On Twitter, it is Alex Webb, @AlexWebb101. On Instagram, it is the same, AlexWebb101. And, of course, on YouTube, it is AlexWebb. I'm the first thing that comes up when you type in AlexWebb. So, yeah, please subscribe, because I need all the help I can get.
Excellent. But yeah, thank you very much for chatting us today.
No problem, man. It's been like a lovely experience. Thank you.